my name is Manette. I'm with Kickstart Ventures. Kickstart is an incubator and investment firm. And a lot of what we do is we invest in startups. So deep, small teams with ideas who want to make a difference in the world. Most of what we invest in are technology startups. These are digital companies that want to do things on the web or on mobile. One of the very special things that Kickstart does is that we invest in social enterprises. And it's really good to see all of you in the room. Yesterday, TechInAsia.com published an article entitled, "Are Asian Startups Ignoring the 99%?" And what that article talks about is that when you look at Asia, 4.3 billion population, 40% of that population, 1.7 billion people, live on $2 a day or less. 80 to 90% live in the rural areas. So poverty is a huge problem, and it is largely rural, and it is something that persists and stays with us for a long, long time. We're interested in trying to find solutions that address wicked problems like poverty, like education, like health for everybody. It's important to us because, as an investor, we want a healthier, sustainable environment around. So when you look at, when you read that article, it tells you, you know, first of all, startups in Asia, small companies, they ignore the 99%. Because when you think of Asia, you know that smartphone penetration is still low, you know that internet penetration is still low, and the incomes are generally low. And so in order to build a good business, you're looking at a market that is measured in terms of a fraction of a fraction of a fraction. What we hope to accomplish in this session is to share with you how that's not necessarily the case, how you shouldn't ignore the 99%, even if you want to build a business, how investors should not ignore the 99% when they're looking at markets. It is possible to take the resources of large corporations like the Ayala Corp, like Singtel, and those are companies that we associate with. It's possible to take the disciplines of startups, of technology, of digital companies. It's possible to take the rigor with which real businesses, you know, big corporations will invest, will make decisions, and build strong, sustainable, social enterprises, businesses that have a social mission, but who will make a real, profitable, and long-term sustainable impact in society. And that's what we're trying to do today. So it's our pleasure to introduce a couple of teams that we've invested in. These guys are battling the odds because Asia's a market that's difficult to penetrate, but it is possible. And we hope that you'll learn from their experience, ask them lots of questions, see what it is that can inspire you perhaps to do something in the social enterprise side. Because these guys, Bagosphere, Ritma, certainly they inspire Kickstart. So let me hand over to Elwin Tan, who is COO and co-founder of Bagosphere.
Actually, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, so maybe I didn't. I'm not used to speaking with the mic. All right. Okay, today, my name is Elwin, right? I am the COO, actually I'm the head of training for Bagosphere. So today I'm here to share with you a few things, right? I think not only about what Bagosphere is doing, but more importantly, I want to share with you the journey that I took from the time when I was like you guys, sitting in conferences, in events and seminars, wanting to know what I could do, right, to impact the world meaningfully. Right. So, right. So, okay. Okay. So, yeah. I'll just ask you guys a question. Has any one of you heard of the term comfort zone?
Yes.
All of you?
Yes.
Do you know exactly what it is?
Yes.
Not so confident.
Yes.
Right. Okay, so what is the comfort zone exactly? Right. Maybe some of you already have a good idea, right? But I think that to keep us all on the same page, I'll just bring you through what is the comfort zone. The comfort zone is where every one of us, not everyone, most of us operate in, right? It is a zone, you know, where we humans like to seek comfort in, right? We as humans are wired, you know, to seek for comfort. Right? We want to feel comfortable, right? Who wants to be in pain, in agony all the time, right? And familiarity, you know, makes us feel comfortable. Do you believe so? Being familiar with our surroundings, with the people, with the locations, the thoughts, the habitual thoughts, the habits, the routines that you take every day, these make you comfortable. And this zone is also the zone where you, where your skills and your abilities lie. Right? It is where you excel at what you do. Am I right?
Yeah.
Right. For example, if I ask you to walk 10 meters, can you do that?
Yes.
Yeah. What about if I ask you to walk 10 kilometers?
I can't run.
Right? You won't be able to do that. Some maybe. Right? So 10 meters is what we call, it's just an exaggeration, but it is the comfort zone that we are talking about. These are things where you feel very comfortable doing. You have no problems doing it at all. And consequently, comfort zone, the comfort zone is a zone of zero growth. Right? Zero growth. Nothing. Right? In this zone, you don't learn anything new. You don't build skills, right? You just stay stagnant, right? Then the next question to you is, why should you care? Why should you care? Because everything, anything that is worth accomplishing, right, is outside your comfort zone, right? Everything. If you're gonna spend time on it, if you're gonna spend effort on it, right, it's worth something to you, right? And it's worth to be accomplished, to be achieved. Right? And stepping out of this comfort zone is not something that is very comfortable. It is risky. Right? When I ask you to step out of your comfort zone, what are the first thoughts that you have? Just now, you know what's her name? Kim? Yeah, Kim was saying, if I ask her to walk 10 kilometers, no way. Right? So she was feeling like, oh, it's not totally out of the question, right? You feel uncomfortable with it. And why is this important, right? This uncertainty, this uncomfortable feeling that you have, you know, is where you are able to push yourself to grow as a person, as individuals. So to leave you a quote that, you know, a quote that I really personally like a lot is, by John F. Kennedy, he said that nothing that is worth accomplishing is ever, with a guarantee of success. Right? And nothing that it's worth accomplishing comes with a guarantee that you're going to succeed. Right? There is always a risk involved. Okay. So for the rest of the presentation, right, I'm going to bring you through four key decisions that I've made in my life, right, that has led me to where I am right now. All right, so first, let me bring you back to my high school days, right? Okay, in Singapore we call it junior college, so it's like a 2 year after high schools. Right? In Philippines it's more like a K plus 12, right? So when I was in high school, after I graduated, in Singapore when I was 19, right? And in Singapore we have this conscript system. Maybe some of you have heard of it, some of you might have it in your country, right? So basically what it means is, once you are above 18, able-bodied, right, any able-bodied man, you have to serve the military for 2 years. Right, you spend 2 years in the army, training with them full time. It's not like part-time study, part-time army. You know, that's not the case. So during these 2 years, you are either sent to, you could be sent to a service support, you become a clerk, to do office work and maybe sit around with the officers drinking tea, right? Or you can call it luckily or unluckily, you might be sent to the front lines. Right? The front lines is where you are the combat units. You go through the hard and, the tough training, go into the jungles, you learn how to operate weapons. Right? So this is NS, right? National Service in Singapore. So to give you a little bit of background on myself when I was at the time, when I was 19, I was still young. I was a sports enthusiast. I love to play soccer or football, right? But I wasn't keen on running, right? And my fitness was really terrible, and it was really, really, in Singapore, terms, you cannot make it, right? Why? Well, I played as the goalkeeper, you know, you can't do much running as the goalkeeper, right? There's only so much, 12 yards that you can run. So I was really had this was really bad with my fitness test. I barely passed it. And imagine after I graduated, I received a letter from the ministry, and I got a letter and I saw, okay, you have been called up to the commandos camp, right, for selection. Right. Does anyone know what is a commando?
Yes.
No. Yes?
The elite armed force.
Yeah, the elite armed forces. It is the toughest vocation that you can get in the army, which is the land units. Right. So everyone there can run. That's the first thing. Right. Has to run. And they carry 20 kgs of load and walk into the jungles, right, for a few days. That's what they do. Right. It's a very, very tough and challenging course. And at that point of time, I was thinking, oh, me? Like, what gives it? Impossible. That was what I thought, my first reaction to it. And because I had the letter, I looked at it, and I took a step back, right? I went to talk to some people, and I tried to keep an open mind and look at it from a different perspective, right? These 2 years is going to be spent whether I like it or not, right? And whether I choose to be in the commandos unit or in any other unit, right, it is still 2 years gone, right? And it is after talking to people about what you can get out of this experience, it inspired me to look forward and not be shackled by the fear that it cannot be done. Right, because anything that is worth accomplishing, is outside your comfort zone. And then I made the decision to join the course. Right. So when I joined the course, the vocation, everyone said I was very crazy. You have a choice. Why do you want to do something like that? Right. So not many people can understand that. Most people want to be comfortable. So what you see here is the door. What you see is from the door of a C-130 airplane, right, where we do our jumps. So commandos also do airborne jumps. We parachute. Right. Sorry?
Exciting.
Yeah, it was exciting. No, the training was tough, as expected, actually. Not expected, it's tougher than expected. Yeah, but the experience that you get there is unparalleled. You get there, you don't get that experience anywhere else compared to the peers. So I remember when I first did my jump, I stood at the door, right? It was 1,000 feet above the ground. So I can feel the air gushing in very, very quickly. My cheeks were pulled back by the wind. Right, I could hear my heart pounding against my chest, right, literally. And everything below looked like minuscule you know, these scale models, the one that you see outside below at the lobby, right? Everything looks like that. And let me tell you, no matter how much training you get, you have before that, you are going to feel scared and nervous. You're going to be trembling, right? And as I was waiting at the door, right? Before this is not me, right? In the military, you can't take pictures. Right? This is something I grabbed from the internet. But it looks like that. Right? So while I was standing at the door, I was waiting for the jail master to tap on my back. So they have to tap you on the back, and then you just leap off. Right? So before that, you just have to stand there and look at the scenery. During that period of time seemed to slow down. Right? Inside my mind, there were only two words, and it was, please open. So I was like, okay, please open. And then I felt that I was gripped by this fear. I was gripped by this fear inside me. And I started to lose focus. Now, I wasn't paying attention to my posture, what I should be doing. And I immediately became aware of that. I had to tell myself and convince myself that, hey, everyone has done this before me, right? Why couldn't I do it, right? And at that point of time, when I started to convince myself, I felt a tap. I was like, okay, I broke out of the internal conversation, closed my eyes, and jumped. Right? The result. Oh, of course, the chute opened. I have a reserve chute. The chute opened, right? And it was an amazing feeling. Right? You have this vast space of peacefulness, serenity that surrounded you, and it was really amazing. It's something that, it's not like standing on top of a mountain, it's different, right? And you just feel so calm, surprisingly, and not scared. And by the time I touched down on the ground, I was like, oh, I want to do it again, right? It was like, oh, it wasn't that scary after all. So, you know, apart from after the experience, apart from leopard crawling across rocky paths, washing truck tires with toothbrushes, right, or jumping off the planes, or carrying a heavy load, walking 70 kilometers in a day, right, each and every one of this experience, right, constantly pushed me to overcome my fears, pushed me to challenge my limits. Right, and you know that once after you've done it, as I've said, shared with you when I jumped, I did my first jump, it wasn't that scary after all. Right, fear is inside the mind. Right, it doesn't exist. It's just the mindset. So, with the experience with in the commando unit, I was unknowingly I built courage. I built my confidence, my courage to really take on the unknown, right? The resilience to not give up, right? The resilience to always try again, right? And after this 2 years in the army, I felt it was a time when I felt that I grew a lot as a person. It built my character. And actually, at the end of the training, I felt like, oh, I believe that I could take on anything in the world. Seriously. Of course, that's not really the case, but you have that kind of confidence in you. So this picture is when I was passing out. Right. So I'm at the bottom right-hand corner. Right, next. So after the army, I went on to college, right, in NUS. I studied in the National University of Singapore. Right, even though I felt that, oh, I had gained this confidence, but I still knew that I had something missing. So, what was it that was missing? Leadership. Now, I have always been very passive. I've been a follower most of the time. And because of this experience with the commandos, I felt that, hey, I could try, right? As long as I wanted to do it, I could try and do it. So in 2008, my friend Ivan, who's also one of our co-founders, right, he had came to the Philippines for a voluntary trip in Bago City, this in central Philippines. And he, when he went back to Singapore, he felt, you know, he fell in love with Bago City. Like, he wanted to go back. And we were talking about it, and there was an opportunity that came up to me. I said, hey, why don't the both of us lead a new team to Bago City, right? And it was, so it, the opportunity seemed to have to just drop, you know, from the sky. You know, out of nowhere, my friend came up and talked to me about it. And this is actually where everything started, right? The first contact with Bago City. So we brought, this is our project, so we brought a team of 16 volunteers, right? It's the first time I was leading such a large team to a foreign land, doing a volunteering project. So we did anything from fundraising, planning, all the way to the execution of the project, painting. So this is an elementary school in Bago City. It's in a rural area, takes about 45 minutes from the city, and a very run-down place before we went. And so we spent about 3 weeks in the Philippines, right, working on the project. And this is, at the end of the project, we have an activity with the kids, where we have some games and all. And this is also the time when I felt that, okay, I felt happy that I accomplished something. But that was before I actually talked to one of the kids in the picture. So there's this little girl, she's called Rosemary, right? So she was 8 years old, right? She caught my notice because during the activity, she was not wearing any slippers, right? She was not wearing any footwear, right, when she was participating in the activity. So I was very curious, like, hey, where are your shoes? And then she told me that, oh, I don't have any, right, because my parents couldn't afford it. So our parents were there as well, and I got to talk to them, and I found out something that's like startling, right? There are so many of them out there that, the parents are working in the fields, right, as farmers or as sugarcane workers, and they earn about $3 to $4 a day. And they know the importance of education, and that's why Rosemary is in school. But there was no way that they could afford things like shoes for them, because they were trying to just survive on a day-by-day basis. Right, so this conversation with the parent sparked a change in me. I immediately had to look back and reevaluate my assumptions and beliefs. Did I really create an impact? Right? Because after doing all this, there are still students who are still not able to, you know, afford the basic necessity in life. Right, even what? So what if I've renovated the school? Right, some might not even come to school because they do not have shoes to come to school. And even for those with shoes, some take 2 hours to walk from their homes to school because they couldn't afford transportation. Right, time is spent on walking and not studying. So after that conversation led me to go back and think about, you know, we in Singapore, we prepared for 6 months, right? We spent $18,000, right, to bring the team, right? We spent $18,000 to bring the team to the Philippines to do this project. And the government sponsored another $18,000, right? So that's $36,000already. And we raised another $30,000 from grants and foundations. And this $30,000 was spent on renovations, like, and feeding programs, like a one-year scholarship for the grade one students. And that's it. $56,000 spent on this, right? More than half of the money is spent to bring us here, bring us to the Philippines. So it doesn't make sense to me, right? It didn't make sense to me, because if you are going to create if you are creating social impact, the money is not spent in the right way. Right? And by that point of time, I was still young, right? And I did not have the exposure, the experience to know what I could do. I could do with this. So, honestly speaking, what I gained from this is that I came to the Philippines at first because of the leadership experience that I wanted to get. And through the experience, you know, I understood about the program, the social impact, the social needs that the world is needing. And it really made me change the way I look at how things are working, like how NGOs, how charities are working, how sustainable are they as the project that they are doing. And that led me to the next major decision. Right, so, of course, I'm not going to party, but after the volunteering trip, the next major decision is to actually go on to an internship program. Right, when, before the trip, my motto was, well, I'm going to spend the rest of my life working. Why should I work when I'm in school, right? I should spend the time having fun, making more friends. But because of the trip, I knew that I was inadequate. I knew that I do not have the experience or the exposure, and that's why I need to learn more. And the third decision was to take up the internship, right, which is an overseas internship for 1 year in Shanghai. Right, and I had to be independent. Right, I had to stay on my own, find jobs, survive there. So, my year in Shanghai, I had an interesting experience. Most of the people, they stay with one company. I had the opportunity to work with two. The first company that I worked for is called Groom Force Pumps. It is a water pump company, MNC from Denmark. So as MNC goes, like, it's more very structured, and things that you do are very, very specialized and niche. And you don't really feel that you are contributing. Right, when I was there, I don't really feel that I was really contributing. I was a marketing executive. I was doing what? Data entry work. I was going online, copying addresses and putting it into a database. So I really didn't feel happy there. And it was in 2009, just a year, or not a year, but right after the financial markets crashed. So basically nothing much was happening. And in the end, I was also part of the cost-cutting measure. So I managed to stay there for about 6 months before I moved to the second company. My second company was a startup. It's a tech startup. It's a virtual world studio. Do you know what is a virtual world? No? Like, Second Life, Habbo Hotel, yeah, things like that. So that was an interesting experience. So I had the autonomy over like small projects, like competitor research. I was able to work on the pricing of virtual items, like the things that you buy inside the virtual world, like furniture, on those clothes. I get to price them, I get to set the difficulty, how much rewards you get. So I can see it implemented in the system, and it was a rewarding experience. Right? It was more dynamic, less structured definitely, right? But the experience was, I gained a lot of exposure and experience because I was able to work on the job. Right. So these two experiences gave me a contrasting view of a sneak preview to what actually the working world looks like. Right. I got an accelerated version of if you were in a company and even when they are doing cost cutting and you're the ones get retrenched, how does it feel like? So it was a crash course, 6 months crash course, very quick. And then in a startup where you really get to know how it feels like to be in a chaotic environment. Everything changes very quickly, right? And it's very intense. And it did, also during this, so these experiences shaped how I looked at my future after that. So apart from the experience working in Shanghai, I was also first introduced to social entrepreneurship. We had lessons there as well. And I attended seminars, like you guys, right? And found out more about social entrepreneurship. And the question that I was asking when I was in a Philippine trip in Bagong City, came into my mind, and you can see that dots are starting to connect from there. Although not clearly, but surely. So when I came back from the program, it was in 2010 already. It was my last semester in NUS, and I would say it is the most challenging period of my school life, and because I was lost, because I was finding it very difficult to reconcile the things that is required in the working world and the things that I'm studying. I'm sure most of you have that experience, like questioning yourself, why am I studying this? Is this, do you need this when you're outside? Well, if you are going to go into that industry, that sector, that niche area, yes, you need, but in general, not really. What I think universities offer us is the perspective, the ability to think critically, right? So I was there really struggling. So like you guys, I tried to find out more about social entrepreneurship. I tried to find out more about myself. And then you see that, okay, when you're sitting in this talk, I think like you, probably some of you will be thinking, well, what can I do? You know, I know I want to do something, but what can I do? There are so many things that I could do, right? What is, I don't have the experience. I don't have the domain knowledge. Right, I guess thinking that way, right? How can I even succeed? How should I even start? Where should I start? That's the question that I was thinking when I was like you. So I didn't know what to do. So that's why, you know, you see all fear, confusion, the doubt, all around. But coincidentally, at the time, I was introduced to Jihan. Jihan is our co-founder as well. Right, so he's the CEO of the company. So he has just returned from a trip in India. He was working in a social enterprise that trains zero educated people in 8 months to be able to speak and write in English and then do back-end BPO jobs. BPO is business process outsourcing, you know, like a data entry and copying, pasting stuff. Right, so they were able to do that. So that, and he was trying to bring that idea into Southeast Asia. So we were introduced by a mutual friend that we met, I met when I was in Shanghai. So he went to this program together with me, right, this mutual friend. And when we sat down together with Ivan, and then we discussed about the idea of bringing training to the Philippines, you know, we felt that, you know, our values, our interests are all very aligned, right, and we really wanted to do it. And that's why we said, okay, let's try and give it a shot. Right, so that led to the last and most important decision that I'm going to talk about. Right. So internally, I was struggling. Right, you want to start a business. You're going to start a business. I was just graduated. I still had my tuition loans. I had to stay away from my family, from Singapore for almost permanently, right? And also I do not have experience or domain knowledge as well. So these are the things I was thinking about, and frankly speaking, it was an excruciating experience, right? Because I already graduated and I do not know what to do. I didn't know what to do. Then I had to reflect and sit down and really think about my past experiences in the Philippines and in Shanghai. What do I really want to achieve in my life, right? And then when I look at how I made my decisions for the past few years of my life, I looked at why I decided to join Commandos, why I decided to go for YEP. The volunteering project. Why did I decide to go to Shanghai? There is a common pattern. Right? There is a common pattern that I tried to step out of my comfort zone. I tried to push to challenge myself, challenge my limits. And then everything cleared up. Right? I plucked my courage, and I took the lead. Right? And then that's when Bible Sphere is born. So, Bible Sphere is our vision is to have a world where every youth can pursue what they love, earn a good living, and build a better future for the next generation. Right? So this is what we believe in. Right? And how we do it is by training youth, by youth doing youth empowerment. But I think saying it will not make it as clear as watching it. Okay, so that's that video.
Si Maria mula sa Baguio City at isa akong call center agent. Marami ang nagugulat kapag nalalaman nila na high school lang natapos ko. Mahirap ang buhay noon at madami akong pangarap. Pero di ko magawang habulin ang mga ito. Nagbago ang lahat, salamat sa Baguio Sphere. Pinili nilang itayo ang Baguio Sphere sa Baguio City, Negros Occidental, imbis na Maynila, dahil nakita nila ang potential ng mga kabataan dito. Isa ako sa kanilang mga pinakaunang estudyante. Sa loob ng 2 buwan, tinuruan nila kami na maging mahusay na call center agent. Ang maganda sa Baguio Sphere, tinuruan nila ako magtiwala sa aking sarili. Pinahusay nila ang aking English, inahanda ako para sa mga call center interview at tinuruan ako ng iba't ibang life skills. Nagbigay pa nga sila ng stationery at libreng sakay. Abot kaya ang training, salamat sa iba't ibang paraan ng pagbayad na sinadya para makatulong sa mga estudyante. At dahil sa tiwala at training nila sa amin, isa ako sa mga unang graduate at natanggap sa isang tanyag na call center. Ngayon, bukod sa pagkita ng mas malaki sa normal, nai-enjoy ko na din ang mga employee benefits habang inutustusan ang sarili kong tuition sa kolehiyo. Muli, ako si Maria, mula sa Baguio City. Isang call center agent at higit sa lahat, isang graduate ng Baguio Sphere.
So I think the video gives a very good idea about what Baguio Sphere is, what we do, and how we are doing it. Right. So what we did was, after the discussion with Jihan and Ivan, we started a pilot project in 2011. We trained 14 students. 13 of them were able to pass the call center selections at the end of the training. Right? And that told us that it gave us a proof of concept that it is actually possible to train high school youth to become call center agents. So in 2012, we came back and we started to raise capital. And we raised funding that we need to start this venture. So luckily, by October 2012, we were able to secure funding. We raised about $120,000, right? And of course, Kickstart is also one of our investors, right? But along with the other private investors as well. So this year we started our operations, right? We started our training, and this is the new training center that we have renovated with the funds. So this is air conditioned and nice. When it was 2004, it was just a cramped little room training 14 students. Now, we are able to train 25 students for every batch of class. And we have also built a strong team of advisors and of course our staff as well. We are able to recruit good trainers, right, good marketing outreach people, and of course admin as well. Admin is also very important now that we realize. So, a testimony from one of the call centers, Teleperformance, is one of the biggest call centers in the Philippines. So Paul Felton is the recruitment manager there, and we have been working very closely with him. You know, he has already has been giving us very good feedback on how our students are performing and how the training could really help the industry. So today, as of today, we have 93 graduates and students, right, and 3 BPO clients that we are working with. We have signed a contract here. By the end of the year, we would have trained 131, because right now we have a current batch ongoing. We are on our fourth batch of students, right? And we send them, actually they'll be graduating in 2 weeks' time. Hopefully they get a job before Christmas. Good Christmas gift for them, for their families. Right, and in 2014, we aim to train 350 and raise a new round of funding then to scale up to the other parts of the facility. By either licensing or training the trainers. Alright, so, well, although we started, it's not all rainbows and butterflies. We all have our challenges as well. It is a very intense process, intense experience. It's not something that is easy, not for the faint-hearted. But we face them every day. We are motivated to continue to tackle them because we believe in making this is something that is worthwhile to accomplish. This is something that is worth our time, worth our effort, to put in our lives. Alright, so when I was looking back, when I look back to the past few years of my life, and especially the point of time when I'm really struggling whether what I should do with my life, I realized something. It is not actually about what you know or you don't. That is not so important. What's more important is what you believe is worth achieving in your life. I know every one of you here, every single one of you, has your own belief, right? You have your own belief, you have your own vision, right? Maybe you want to solve poverty, you want to eradicate poverty, or you want to save the planet, right? Maybe you want to be the next Steve Jobs, Bill Gates, right? It doesn't matter, right? It doesn't matter what you want to do, what you want to do, right? What is more important is what you do with this belief, right? Because everything, the belief that you have, is something that is worth accomplishing, it's worth your effort, it's worth your time. And the uneasiness with the uncertainties, right, of this stepping out of your comfort zone is always going to be there. It's never going to go away, it's always going to be there, right? So for you, I think the thing is, you need to take the courage and just make the jump, right? So I'll leave you with, before I leave you with the last quote, I want you guys to go back tonight, before you sleep, right? Reflect on your experiences. Think about the decisions that you have made, the experiences that you have had. How have you made those decisions, right? Have you taken the comfort route, or have you taken a step out of your comfort zone, right? Your life is waiting for you at the end of the comfort zone. Right, thank you very much.
I'm a musician sometimes. I'm a lawyer sometimes. But I'm full-time CEO and co-founder of Ritmo Learning Lab. Alright, so we start with the why. I want to start with the why we're doing this. Why it makes sense to us. And we have to look at the situation in the Philippines. Okay, we are overpopulated. That's a wide known fact. There are 103 million Filipinos on this earth. The poverty line, there are 18 million Filipinos who live below the poverty line. That poverty line is defined by 50 pesos or $1.20. That's half a mocha latte at Starbucks. 18 million in the Philippines, 18 million Filipinos live below that line. There are 38,000 public schools servicing 15 million kindergarten to grade school Filipinos. There are 377,000 public school teachers servicing 15 million kinder and grade school kids. The teacher-student ratio is 1:65. I come from a family of six. We are six. I have five other siblings, and we battle for our parents' attention every day when we were growing up. Imagine there are 65 of you that a teacher has to teach day in and day out. The dropout rate is 7%. If you're talking about 15 million students, 7% of 15 million, that's in the millions. Kids who drop out for various reasons. They're not having fun in school. It's hard for them to go to school because, as Elwin mentioned earlier, no slippers, no money for books, no money for decent clothes. They end up not being interested in school and, hey, you know what, I'm just gonna drop out. I'm just gonna work with my dad or with my mom. We're going to pick garbage. We're going to sell whatever it is that we need to sell. Backlog. The Philippines right now needs 60,000 additional teachers. We need 61,000 additional classrooms. And get this, we need 90,000 toilets in public schools. That's the situation that we're in. So one day, my co-founder Caris came to me and said, at the time she was a preschool teacher in La Salle, and she said, hey, why don't we make music for kids? Because there's not enough music for kids. She and I have been entrenched in the music industry for the longest time because her older brother is the drummer Flipper Maya. I, being a musician, and my brother Epe Denzel used to sing for Sugar Free, and he was also part of the music industry. And we've talked about making music for kids, but the more we talked about it, the more it became clear that there is a bigger mission to music, so far as education is concerned. We wanted to make learning fun. We wanted to use songs to service 15 million public school kids. Create learning tools that are music driven so that kids don't have to drop out. So that kids will actually have fun learning, will actually value education, and grow up thinking that learning is fun, because I did not have fun in school. From grade school to high school to college to law school, there's always something about school that did not sit well with me. So now, we're trying to change it for future generations. And so, Republikha was born. Republikha is a non-stop, non-profit corporation. We're based in the university, the Ateneo University. And what we do is we develop learning tools that use music for marginalized communities, for public schools. You guys familiar with Sesame Street?
Yes.
We want to compete with Sesame Street. We want something out of the Philippines that will go toe-to-toe with Sesame Street. So, what do we do? We create fun learning tools, but how? We developed a curriculum along with a consultant from the UP Child Development Center, Early Child Development Center, and from NEST, it's a progressive school. Came up with a curriculum that's based on the five learning domains. We started preschool. Why did we start preschool? Because we want to start them really young. So we started with preschool, five learning domains. Kinesthetic, social, emotional, etc., etc. Caris will discuss it later. So based on those learning tools, we created topics. And then from those topics, we assigned it to artists. We spoke to a bunch of artists who did not give a second thought of joining us for kids all over the Philippines. So what did they do? They took those topics, and they created songs with it. And then we just had to sit them down and tell them that the following are the parameters. And the song has to be in the key of C, because toddlers are, the preschool kids are supposed to be able to sing it. It has to be repetitive, and it has to be in English and in Tagalog and in Filipino. We're starting with English and Filipino. Eventually, we want to translate those songs to the different dialects and to different languages. Hello. You okay? Okay, so what do we do with those songs? Along with those songs, we created a teaching module for public school teachers. The module was supposed to teach the teachers how to integrate those songs into existing curriculum. We are not reinventing the wheel, we're just making it more fun. Just adding color, put bubbles and stickers and music. And we tested these songs initially in 36 classrooms to see how the kids would react. Because we told the artists, you have to sound like yourselves. So the Dawn had to sound like themselves. And Gary Valenciano had to sound like himself. And the Itchworms and this independent ska group called Coffee Break Island, they had to play ska. Because we did not want to insult the intelligence and taste of the kids. And we wanted kids to appreciate music the way it's being played, not some bastardized, kindered down music that you spoon feed to your kids because you think that they're not smart enough to understand music, right? So we tested it, and then we came up with learning tools that are bilingual, that are music driven, and the goal really is to develop lifelong learners among marginalized communities. Public schools, kids in public schools who will stay in school from grade school, who will dream that there's something good that will come out of this, and will push and push and push until they hit college, until they do something. They do something, make something out of their lives, and get themselves out of that hellhole that they find themselves in. So they didn't have a choice, they were born in it. So, the next question was, how are we going to do it? Because we're not philanthropists and millionaires. Yeah. We're a non-profit organization. Oh wait, before we go there, let me just play a couple of songs. This is by the Itchworms, and it's about making friends.
All of us need a good friend. All of us can be good friends.
This next song is by Gary Valenciano and his son Paolo, who has a band, Salamin. And this is about the right to play. And the next song is by Jolina Magdangal and River Maya. They made the song before they got married, to those who are not from the Philippines. Jolina's a very popular.
Books are all around, some are big and some are small. Come and read a book with me.
Thank you. So, but now the next step for us was to figure out how the hell are we going to do this? Because the first question that we had to tackle was sustainability. How do you sustain it? What I learned from being a human rights lawyer for the last 14 years was that you cannot depend on grants alone. Because they change your mind. They change your focus. The money is, the well is not perpetual. So, you're talking about empowerment, and you yourself have to be empowered. And with everything that you do, I believe it's always been about two things. One, it's always been about empowerment. Two, it's about financial sustainability. And one cannot do without the other. Because if it's all empowerment, 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 and you cannot buy food, you cannot pay your cell phone bills, you cannot sustain your projects, you cannot make new songs, you cannot record new songs, you cannot test it in different schools, and then all you have is a really cute project. If it's all just about financial sustainability, then you become soulless. Then you lose sight of why you do the things that you do. So it's always about finding that balance between what you have to do to survive, to pay the bills, to pay the rent, and what you need to do for your own soul. And I don't believe that those two are mutually exclusive. It's not a choice of it's either I do what I want, and I will be smiling forever even if I'm hungry, because my soul is sinking there. See, I don't want to be that person. On the other hand, I don't want also to be that person who's just all about money, 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 money. Right? So I believe that the struggle really is to find that balance between the two. And this is what we happily so struggle with every day. The second question is scaling. Because we want to reach as many kids as possible. We want to reach all the kids in the public school sector, all marginalized communities. And we want to reach out to kids in the middle and upper classes as well, because they deserve as much. Because they have access to more junk. If you think about it, they have access to more junk than kids in marginalized areas whose lives are just way simpler than theirs. So scaling, how do you scale? And we want, and if we're going to compete with Sesame Street, then we really have to scale. So, Ritmo Learning Lab was born. Ritmo Learning Lab is a stock and profit corporation. We are part of Launch Garage 2. It is an incubation acceleration program that is headed by Kickstart and ProudCloud. So Kickstart, ProudCloud, and Republica, they make up Ritmo Learning Lab. We're a bunch of dreamers and businessmen and musicians and teachers and development workers, and we want to do it right. You know, it's sometimes it's a question of doing the right thing and doing it properly, right? So we want to do the right thing, but we want to do it properly. Because if you don't do it properly, then it's not going to make sense. And Kickstart and ProudCloud so far have given us amazing mentorship in doing the things that we do. But what does Ritmo do? We are addressing two things. Number one, learning can be boring. Number two, there is a growing gap between parents and children that's created by technology. Okay, so Republica goes to marginalized communities, to public schools, it trains teachers, it makes education more fun. But to be able to sustain that, we need logistics. We need to make money. So Ritmo Learning Lab creates technology-based, music-driven learning tools for parents and their kids. Because we want, number one, we want parents to reconnect with their kids again. Because there's a gap. How many of you guys have seen this scenario? Okay, shut up, here's the iPad. You're too noisy. The adults are talking. Here's an iPhone. What is that Candy Crush that you are doing? You know, all of a sudden, parents and their kids stop talking, because the last link between them was the television, the VCD player, the DVD player. And then when technology became available to younger kids, and then the kids got caught up in their own world. And then parents, some of them are just too happy. Some are just so scared of what the kids are doing that they don't know how to reconnect anymore. So what we do in Ritmo is we keep parents relevant because we want them to reconnect with their kids. they stay involved, and they stay connected with their kids. And in along the way, you know, they both learn about each other and about fun, cool stuff. So, we sell to middle class, upper class, and private educational institutions. And the proceeds from there will go to Republica so that Republica can service marginalized communities. So it's very important that we scale, because if we do not scale, then you cannot measure anything. There is no social impact. We just created a bunch of really cute songs with really cool artists. Okay, so we came up with Juma Jam. Bilingual, technology-based, music-driven, 9 lessons for volume 1 of preschool, 18 songs, 18 because it's in English and Tagalog, 9 lessons in English and Tagalog. We see this spreading across the archipelago, across Asia, and the world. That'll be fun. It's fun. But we have here an animation of how Juma Jam works.
Learning can be boring. In school or at home, learning becomes a chore. Kids would rather play on their gadgets, and with all the busyness of grown-up life, technology sometimes creates a growing gap in families. Lost in a virtual world, kids get exposed to inappropriate messages. What's a parent to do? Suddenly, technology becomes the bad guy. But technology can be your friend. Say hi to Ritmo the robot. He and his friends have spent the past few years researching, experimenting, and perfectionizing Juma Jam, a collection of fun and engaging songs with lessons that make learning fun. Lessons about colors, making friends, playing, and so much more. We are hacking education by changing the way parents engage with their kids. Through fun and simple-to-use apps, Juma Jam creates teachable moments that reconnect families and breathe life to boring lessons. Kids and grown-ups get to learn new things, go on adventures, and sing along to original Philippine music that you can jam to. Through Juma Jam, we envision a future with stronger families and kids who love learning and will change the world. Juma Jam, the soundtrack to your child's growing up years.
So what we're trying to do really is we're trying to hack into education and reimagine it, make it fun, and develop lifelong learners, reconnect parents, and service communities. This is where we, like I said earlier, happily struggle with finding that balance between financial sustainability and empowerment. So to do a product demo, because we're releasing, if you guys have time later on, the Mac users here, you can download the first iBook on jumajam.com. It's about colors. We're releasing 9. Hopefully by December 24, we will be releasing a phone app for these learning tools as well. And by next year, we will be working at volume 2 of preschool. And then after volume 2 of preschool, we're gonna hit the ground running and start developing learning tools for grades, no, for kinder up to kindergarten up to grade 3. Okay, so please give it up for Carissa Escueta.
Good afternoon, my name is Carissa. So I'll do a quick walkthrough so you can see what we've been working on. This is our lesson on colors. This is part of volume 1 of Juma Jam for preschool, featuring the artists Julianne and Barbie Almalvis. So once you open the iBook, basically you'll see right away the quick start page, which explains what Juma Jam is all about. That it engages the listener, it sparks the imagination, and that it is music that works. The idea behind all of this text is that the reader is a grown up and not a child. Because normally you expect, oh, it's for kids, I'll give it to my child. Or ordinary, I'll give it to my niece or my younger cousin, but this is actually for grown-ups, specifically parents. But of course, if you have young children in your lives, then definitely this is also for you. So this is a continuation of the parents' guide, just really walking you through on how to use Juma Jam and the activities that you'll find in every lesson. And as you can see in the bottom, we always stress that the most important thing is that you have fun. Because once it starts to become work for you, that's what you're gonna inspire the child, that it's really not fun. So, as you move forward, I wanted to focus a little bit on the five learning areas that Juma Jam has for every iBook. And I don't know if there are education majors here or any teachers in the room, but there are a lot of theories on learning, and we just decided to choose one since there it's an endless debate with educators, and we decided to go with the learning domains. So for us, we call it the five learning areas of Juma Jam. You have your cognitive, which is all the facts and the knowledge. Creative, obviously that's the artsy stuff. And there's linguistic, all the vocabulary and the words. Physical is anything you do with your body. And social-emotional is your feelings and your behaviors and your values, your attitudes. So what we're saying is that when you're listening to a song, it doesn't just affect your ears or your sense of hearing, but there's a lot of stuff that's going on. Maybe if you're having a bad day, one of the things that you'll do is you'll listen to your favorite song so you can feel better. Or if you're going through a tough time because you broke up with a girlfriend or a boyfriend and then you hear this song that you guys used to play together, it affects you. Because music is instant. It impacts us right away. So this is the page that talks about the actual lesson. You can see on the bottom, it talks about why parents need to talk about this topic with children and what they can do at 4 to 7 years old. And so you won't expect too much or under expect from what they can do. And if you see on the right, the red box there, that's all the learning activities that you can do based on the song. So let's say we want to do something physical with the song and with the child. You can see that there's a very instant game you can play called Touch the Color. This is very famous in the Philippines. A lot of children grew up playing this. And all you basically do is you tell your child, oh, touch the color red. And they run around looking for things that are red and they touch it. So what we're also saying is that it doesn't have to be hard, it doesn't have to be complicated or expensive to engage with your child. And it empowers you to be able to reach in to where your child is at and say, okay, I want to reconnect with you. I don't need to buy you a new Lego set to do that. I can just do this with you right away. So here are the other, so for social-emotional, there's something like using colors to convey emotions, and you can talk about how people use that sometimes to describe how they're feeling because sometimes they don't have words. Or in art, that's how we convey emotion through color. So you have linguistic, you can discuss their favorite color where there is no right or wrong answer. A lot of the times, the way we raise children is that there's only a right or wrong, and if they're not in any one of those, then they have a problem. But things like this, where there is no right or wrong answer, if you like blue and I happen to like red, doesn't make us better or worse than the other. It just means we like different things. Okay. So this is the actual song already in video format with animation. And you have, since we have English and Tagalog, this is the English version.
Colors, lots of colors. Do so many things with colors. Red, yellow, and blue. Let's see what we can do. Red and yellow mixed together. Orange says hello. Red and yellow mixed together. Orange says hello. Colors, lots of colors. Do so many things.
I warn you, you'll be singing that till next week. So it basically talks about primary colors, red, yellow, and blue, and how when you mix them, they become secondary colors. You have the lyrics down here as well. And you also have it in the animation itself. Actually, if I could flip this to horizontal, the whole screen will become the animation, but that's all right. Since we are in also we are also using Tagalog, here's the Tagalog version.
Kulay madami kulay, luluin natin ang mga kulay. Pula, dilaw, bughaw, hayo na ko at ikaw.
So if you're trying to learn Tagalog, that's a nice way to start learning. There are we have in mind that there are a lot of Filipino families who are raising children outside of the Philippines, or they are mixed. They are of another, their father or their mother is another nationality and the other partner is a Filipino. So even the parent probably needs to learn Tagalog to bring that sense of Filipino identity into the home. We also have the music sheet and the chords in case you can play an instrument or you can read notes. And if you want to change the tempo or the arrangement, that's all up to you. We also want to honor the artists who have supported the project. And it also gives parents and grown-ups ideas about other artists that they can look for their children. And it's not all Miley Cyrus or whoever, Drake, or whoever kids are listening to now. And this is more information about Juma Jam. So if you do want to look for us, we are on jumajam.com. You can download via this website. And as of the moment, it's still for free. So if you have an iPad or your laptop is on Mavericks, this is definitely something you might want to download once you get back to your hotel room or you get back.
Thank you, Chris. Next year, it will be available in all devices across platforms. Initially, we're doing Apple. We'll be selling at around $2.99 to $3.99. But you guys have until December 6th to download Colors if you like that song. Because I heard people groaning when we stopped the song. So you can go to jumajam.com and please tell your friends, tweet about it, post it on your Facebook page. It's jumajam.com. When you support Ritmo, you're actually supporting communities all over the country. So, thank you and good afternoon. Mabuhay ka.